Good afternoon. We'll continue the lecture on deriving the equations of motion of a multi-degree of freedom system. In general, the equation of motion actually we have several equations depending on the number of degrees of freedom, and the general form is this. We have a mass matrix multiplied by the acceleration vector plus the damping matrix multiplied by the vector of the velocities plus the stiffness matrix multiplied by the vector of the displacement equal to the vector of the external forces. In the special case where we have 2 degrees of freedom, the mass, damping and stiffness matrices are 2 by 2 matrices. We have 2 degrees of freedom, x1 and x2, and 2 forces. So this is the general expression for the equation of motion. For 2 degrees of freedom, you have accelerations of these 2 degrees of freedom, and this can be either displacements or rotations. So the problem of deriving the equations of motion reduces to the determination of the elements of the matrices. So in the case of a 2 degree of freedom system, you have to determine 4 elements for the mass matrix, 4 elements for the damping, and 4 elements for the stiffness matrix. Okay, now in order to determine these elements, one way to do so is to use the what we call the unit displacement method. What we do is we find the force that is needed in order to produce a specific displacement or acceleration or velocity. So if we go to this equation, then in this equation we have the element that is in the second row of the stiffness matrix, M21, second row, and this denotes the direction of the displacement. And we have the force that is needed in order to produce a unit acceleration in this direction, in direction 1. And this force is applied to this degree of freedom 2. And then if you divide that by the acceleration of this degree of freedom, then you have this element of the mass matrix. So M21 is essentially this force, which is the force to the second degree of freedom that is needed to produce a displacement of this degree of freedom that is specified by the second subscript equal to a unit, while all other displacements, velocities, and accelerations are 0. Okay, so if you look at this term that is on the numerator, the first subscript, which is 2 in this case, specifies the body to which the force should be applied. And 1 is the direction of the displacement. Okay? We did already, we started doing an example, which is shown here. This is the figure that shows the problem and the system. We have to derive the equations of motion of this 2 degree of freedom system. The 2 degrees of freedom are the displacement of the cart, this cart, x1, and then the rotation of the rod, which is x2. This is an angle. And we already derived the stiffness matrix K of this element, of this system. So The first element that corresponds to the first degree of freedom is K1, which is the spring rate of the spring, okay, the rate of this spring. And the second element that is on the other, on this here, it is K2, the torsional stiffness or rotational stiffness of this spring minus the mass times G times A. So what it means is that if you look at this stiffness matrix, what it means is that if you want to create a displacement equal to one unit for this mass, you want to move this mass by one unit to the right, then the force that you have to apply to this mass is equal to K1, the spring rate, okay? This should be clear intuitively, because all you have to do is to stretch by one unit the spring in order to be able to move the mass by one unit, okay? So the force to stretch the spring is K1. Now, let's look at this element. This is the element that corresponds to the degree of freedom 2. This is the element K22. What is this? This is the moment that we need to exert to the rod in order to rotate it by one unit. While M is, doesn't move. So if you make a mental experiment thinking that you are trying to rotate this vertical rod by one unit, then the moment that you need is K2, the stiffness of the spring, K2, the torsional spring, minus the weight of this rod times A, this distance. The reason that we subtract MGA is because when you rotate the rod, then there is a moment that helps you actually to rotate it. So you don't have to overcome just K2. You have to actually, because this moment helps you, what you have to overcome is the resistance of K2 minus MGA. Okay, so this is how we get these two elements. The other two elements, the non-diagonal elements, are zero. This means that you don't have any stiffness coupling. So we can say that we have no stiffness coupling. And no stiffness coupling means that if you try to displace one degree of freedom by applying a force, no force needs to be exerted to the other degree of freedom, specifically the rod, in order to keep the displacement, in order to keep x2 equal to zero. Okay, so this is what the zero elements in the non-diagonal imply. Okay. Now we'll continue this example and find the mass matrix, the inertia matrix, and then we'll talk about another method to derive the equations of motion, which uses energy principles. We already derived equations of motion for single degree of freedom systems using energy principles, and we'll extend the presentation to 2 degrees of freedom. So let's talk about the mass matrix. This system, by the way, has no damping. So this matrix that multiplies the velocities is zero. So all we have to do is to determine the mass matrix. Okay. We consider first an acceleration x1. We consider that we accelerate the car by x1 double dot. All other displacements, velocities, accelerations are zero. For example, the acceleration of the rod is zero, and so are all other quantities, such as, say, x2. The rod does not rotate. Okay, let's make a sketch and see what forces are needed to produce this result. So here we have the rod, and then we have the mass here. The mass is an acceleration x1 double dot, and then here is the center of gravity of the rod. We exert the moment m2 1m in general in order to keep the rod vertical, and then we also need to exert the force F11 on the cart in order to accelerate it. Okay. So again, we have an acceleration x1 double dot for the cart. The rod doesn't move, it remains vertical. And we want to see what forces are needed to produce this result. So what we'll do is consider first the lower body and the forces that are exerted. Consider lower body. Okay. We have this part. We exert the force F1 1m on the cart. The acceleration of the cart is x1 double dot. And then there is a force that is exerted from the vertical rod to the cart. So when you try to accelerate the cart, the rod has some inertia. So as a result, there is some resistance that you need to overcome. So the force is denoted by F prime. Okay, Newton's law in the horizontal direction, summation of all the forces equal to the mass times the acceleration. So the summation of all the forces on the cart is equal to mx1 double dot. Okay, so if you write here the expression for the forces, you have that minus F prime, okay, this force, plus the force exerted to the cart, F11 M, equal to M times the acceleration of the cart. So we have equation one. Now this equation is not sufficient in order to find the force F11m, okay? Because we have F prime. So we need more information, and what we need to do is to consider the beam, the vertical beam. So consider beam. Here, the moment, the center of gravity is g. We have an acceleration x1 double dot. Okay, so this is equal to the acceleration of the current. We consider no rotation, so the acceleration of the center of gravity of the rod is equal to the acceleration of the car. Okay, that's why we say that the acceleration of the vertical beam is x1 double dot. Okay, we need to exert a moment to the rod in order to keep it vertical. So this is M21M. Okay? And also, we have the force from the cart to the rod, which is equal and opposite to F prime on the cart. Okay? So, when you try to accelerate the cart, then if you don't apply any moment to the rod will lean backward because of inertia. So you need to exert a moment to the rod in order to keep the rod vertical. That's why we have M21. Okay, and we write the equation for moments in this equation, for forces first. The summation of all the forces is equal to the mass times the acceleration, and this is equal to capital M, the mass of the rod, times the acceleration, x1, double dot, of the car. Okay? Remember, the rod is, in this kind of mental experiment, vertical. Okay, so F, that means that F prime is equal to the mass of the rod times x1 double dot. That's F prime. Okay, we put F prime in equation 1, okay? So if you put F prime into equation 1, then you'll be able to find F11m. So you have minus M x1 double dot plus F11 M equal to M x1 double dot. That means F11m is equal to the mass of the cart plus the mass of the rod times the acceleration of the cart. Okay? So that means that M11 this means that M11 is equal to the sum of the two masses. So this is the upper diagonal element of the mass matrix. And if you think about it, that makes sense that this element is the sum of the two masses. Because if you try to accelerate the car and the rod is vertical, you have to overcome the inertia both of the car, which is lowercase m, and the inertia of the rod, which is capital M. So this is the mass of the rod. So the total force is the summation of the two masses. Okay, so we found one element of the mass matrix. Now, we can continue to find the other element. In order for the rod to remain vertical, the sum of the moments about G should be zero. So sum of the moments should be zero about the center of gravity of the rod. Okay? And this means that M minus F prime times A should be equal to zero. Okay? That means M21M is equal to M times A times the acceleration of the cat. Okay? So the element of the mass matrix that is in the second row and the first column is equal to M21M divided by the acceleration x1 double dot, which is m times a. Okay, so we found also the element of the mass matrix in the lower the lower element in the first column, m21, and this is equal to ma. Okay, now in order to find the elements in the second column, we have to consider a rotation of the rod, keeping the cart in the fixed position, so it doesn't have acceleration. Okay. In order to find M12 and M22, we consider that the rod now rotates. So we have the cart. Now the rod rotates and it has an acceleration. Angular acceleration x double dot. Okay, so this is x double dot and now the cart is not moving. Okay, so x2 double dot is what is non-zero, and then x1 double dot is zero. The rest of the degrees of freedom are also there. The rest of displacements, velocities are equal to zero too. Okay, we consider the lower body again, the car, and we write Newton's law for the car. Newton's law for cart. Here is the cart. We apply a force to the cart. This is F12M. M means that we work with acceleration, so we have to deal with inertias, and this is the body, that we apply the force, and this is the direction. There is a force, F prime, that is exerted from the rod to the cup. So we write Newton's law, summation of all the forces is equal to the mass times the acceleration. And since there is only rotation and the car remains still, this is zero. So these two forces are equal and opposite. So F 1 to M is equal to F prime. Okay, so we have this equation here. Okay, now let's see what happens to the rod. We'll write Newton's law for the rod. The rod is rotating. And this is the vertical position, this is the center of gravity G. We have angular acceleration, x2 double dot. There is a force equal to F prime that is exerted from the cart to the rod. And we have a moment on the rod, okay? Why is it clockwise? Why is this moment that we need to exert clockwise? Well, the reason is that in order to rotate the rod and give it an acceleration, a moment has to be applied, okay? Now, the force that is exerted to the cart is in this direction, okay? So we write the equation for moments, summation of the moments is equal to the moment of inertia about the center of gravity. Here we write the equation for moment, and the reference point is the center of gravity times x2 double dot. Okay, so we have m22m minus the moment of F prime, which is F prime times the distance A, equal to the moment of inertia times the angular acceleration of the rod. The summation of all the forces on the rod is equal to the mass of the rod times the acceleration, which is x double dot times a. Remember, x double dot is angular acceleration, so you multiply it by the length to find the acceleration, the linear acceleration, okay? So from this equation, the force F prime is equal to the mass of the beam times A times x2 double dot. Okay? Once you get F prime from here, you put it in this equation in order to find M22. So you have that M22, M equal to the moment of inertia Ig times x2 double dot plus F prime A, which means that M22 is equal to the moment of inertia of the rod about its center of gravity times m a squared times the angular acceleration of the rod. Okay? So m22 is this moment normalized by x2 double dot. So the lower diagonal element of the mass matrix is Ig plus m a squared. Okay. We have also said that F12 M is equal to F prime, okay? And we have F prime, so if we divide that by x2 double dot, we get the element M12, which is the mass of the rod times A. Okay, now we are ready to assemble the mass matrix of the system. We have all the four elements. So the mass matrix is lowercase m, the mass of the cart plus the mass of the rod, ma, and then moment of inertia of the rod plus m a squared. Okay, so this is the mass matrix. Now we see that the mass matrix has diagonal elements. This means that there is inertia coupling. Okay? So there is inertia coupling and we infer that from the fact that the mass matrix is non-diagonal. This means that if you try to accelerate say, the rod, you got to also apply a moment in order to keep it from rotating. Notice also that this matrix is diagonal. I'm sorry, diagonal. It is a symmetric matrix. The elements that are, the non-diagonal elements are equal. Okay, so the equation of motion is this. Lowercase m, uppercase m, ma, moment of inertia of the rod plus ma square times the acceleration of the cart and the angular acceleration of the rod plus the stiffness of the spring that holds the cart, connects it to the wall, 0, 0. Times the vector of the displacements. And if you don't have any forces, the right hand side is 0. So this is the equation of motion. Okay? And because, again, the matrix of the masses is has diagonal elements, you have inertia coupling. Inertia coupling. And because the stiffness, here the diagonal element is K2 minus MGA. Because this matrix is diagonal, then you don't have stiffness coupling. No stiffness coupling. Okay, so we saw this approach to derive the equations of motion of a two-degree of freedom system. Now, an alternative approach that sometimes is easier to apply is using energy principles. And we talked about how to use energy principles to derive the equations of motion of a single degree of freedom system. And now we'll apply this same method to a system with multiple degrees of freedom. Okay. So energy method. We have to use the Lagrange equations. And these equations have this form, partial derivative of the kinetic minus the potential energy with respect to each degree of freedom, minus the derivative of the partial derivatives of the difference between the kinetic and potential energy with respect to velocities plus the non-conservative forces is equal to 0. For a two degree of freedom system, you have two equations, I equal to 1 and 2. Again, T is the kinetic energy. V is the potential energy. And QI is the non-conservative force acting on the particular degree of freedom. Okay? So QI is non-conservative force. Non-conservative force means damping force. Now, let's explain what non-conservative force is, this term QI. Well, I'll see how to find QI. Okay, we consider the displacement delta x1. X1 is the first degree of freedom. The work produced by non-conservative force at degree of freedom 1 is delta W1, which is the non-conservative force times delta X1. So Q1, the non-conservative force, is delta W1 divided by delta x1. And similar equation, there's a similar equation for Q2. So Q2 is delta W2 divided by delta x2. Okay, as an example, we have two masses. The first mass is suspended from the ceiling. There is a spring with stiffness K2 and the damper with damping coefficient C2. And then a second mass connected to the first, so the second, the lower mass is M1, the stiffness is K1, and this is the damper is C1. Now, we make a mental experiment. We think that we move M2 downwards by X2. X2, okay? Now, X2, we don't do it slowly, we have an X2, and there is a velocity, the derivative of that is a velocity, and that is non-zero. Okay, the force that is exerted has to be exerted to this mass is this, and at the same time, we displace M1 by X1. And there's another force here, okay? So the force on the upper mass is equal to C1 times x1 dot minus x2 dot, okay? And there is also a force C2 because of the second damper times x2 double dot, okay? And then if you look at the lower mass, there is only a force which is in the upward direction, equal and opposite to this force. So it is equal to C1 times x1 dot minus x2 dot. Okay, so in order to find K1, you divide the work that is produced from because of X1. So the work that is produced on X1 is equal to this force times delta X1. So if you normalize by X1, then you find that Q1 is equal to C1 times x2 double dot minus x1, I'm sorry, x2 dot minus x1 dot. And for Q2, you have, it's right here, for Q2. Q2 is equal to C1 times x1 dot minus x2 dot minus C2 x2 dot. Okay, so these are the non-conservative forces. All right, let's solve the same problem with the cart and the vertical rod again, using energy principles. So we'll rewrite this equation of motion using energy principles. So same system as before. We have the cart, mass M. It is constrained to the wall with a spring K1. We have this rod, the vertical rod. It rotates by an angle x2. There is a torsional spring K2. The displacement is x1 for the cart. The center of gravity is g, and the distance of the center of gravity from this connection point, this pivot, is a. We like to derive the equations of motion again using energy principles. So in order to do that, we have to write an expression for the kinetic energy and also an expression for the potential energy. Okay? So let's start with the kinetic energy. So our objective at this step is to write an expression for T. That's what we're trying to do. Okay? So now we have a combined motion where the mass moves to the right, there's some velocity, there's also a rotation, this bar rotates, so we like to write the kinetic energy. Okay? The kinetic energy is the kinetic energy of the cart, which is 1/2 the mass times the acceleration of the cart, which is x1 double dot square. So we have 1/2 m x1 dot square. This is the kinetic energy of the cart. Now we have to add the kinetic energy of the rod. Now the rod is doing two motions. One is the rotation about this point, and the other is the movement of the center of the gravity. Okay? And the movement of the center of gravity is the combination of x1 plus the movement because of the rotation, which is this angle times this distance a. Okay, so for the rod we have, for the rod we have 1/2 times the moment of inertia about the center of gravity times the angular velocity square, okay? But again, we have also to consider the movement of the center of gravity, the linear movement. So this is equal to 1/2 the mass of the rod times the velocity of the center of gravity square. The velocity of the center of gravity is a times the rotation, the derivative of the rotation. So this is because the angular velocity plus the velocity of the cart. Because when you move the cart, the rod also moves. So we have to add to it x1 dot square. So this is the due to rotation about g. Okay, this is because of rotation of the rod about g, and this is due to translation And what you see here in the parentheses is the velocity of the center of gravity, velocity of g, which is because of the motion of the cart and also the rotation of the rod. That's why we have the summation. Okay, so this is the kinetic energy. So we are done with the kinetic energy. We need also to consider the potential energy B. Well, the potential energy is 1/2 the stiffness of the spring times the stretching of the spring square. Okay, so that's the first term. Now we consider also the potential energy because the angular deformation of this rod, okay. Which is 1/2 k2 x2 squared. This is because of the rotation of the distortion of the spring, because of the rotation x2. And we have to consider also another term, which is because the center of gravity of the rod goes down. So because the center of gravity is lower as we rotate the rod, there is one term that has to do with the potential energy. This is negative because we lose potential energy when the center of gravity goes down. And this is equal to minus mgA, okay, the mass, times g times a, and then the amount that the center of gravity goes down, which is 1 minus cosine x2. All right, so now we'll use, we have found the moments of, the potential energies. So now we use these equations, these Lagrange equations, to find the equation of motion. Let's start with the first degree of freedom. We have dt minus v dx1 this is equal to minus k1 x1 dt minus v with respect to the velocity. This is mx1 dot plus capital M ax1 dot, x2 dot plus x1 dot. Okay, now we need to take the derivative with respect to time. So dt partial t minus b with respect to x1 dot is equal to mx1 double dot plus capital M ax2 double dot plus x1 double dot. Okay, so the first equation of motion can be derived using this and this equation, and this is the sum of the two masses times x1 double dot, the acceleration, plus mx2 double dot plus k1 x1 equal to 0. That's the first equation. And if you check, it's the same equation as we derived using the unit displacement method. Okay? Now, let's work with the other degree of freedom. So now we take derivatives with respect to x2. Derivatives with respect to x2. Okay? The partial derivative with respect to x2 is minus k2 x2 plus mgA sine x2. Okay. Now we take derivative of t minus v, kinetic minus potential energy with respect to the velocity, dt minus v with respect to the velocity x2 dot equal to the moment of inertia of the rod times the angular velocity plus the mass times a x2 dot plus x1 dot times a. Now we take the derivative of this expression and we get v dt partial of t minus v with respect to x2 dot equal to just moment of inertia of the rod about the center of gravity times the angular acceleration of the rod plus mass times x2 dot plus x1 double dot times a. And combining these two terms will give you the second equation of motion. So let's write that. The second equation is m ax1 double dot plus moment of inertia plus m a square x2 double dot plus k2 x2 minus m g a sine x2 equal to zero. That is the second equation. Now, everything looks okay except that we had a sine here. We didn't get a sine when we worked with a unit displacement method. So what happened is we made an approximation that because the angle of rotation is small, the sine of the angle is equal to the angle itself when we express the angle in the radians. Okay, so let's make the same approximation in order to be fair. So we make this approximation that the sine of the angle is approximately equal to x2. And if you do that, then you get the equation that is the same as the equation that we got from the unit displacement method. So we have MA x1 double dot plus IG plus MA square x2 double dot plus K minus MG A x2 equal to zero. And that is the second equation And this is exactly the same as the equation that we had using the unit displacement method. Okay, so we talked about two methods to derive equations of motion of a system, and both methods can be used to get the equations of multi-degree of freedom systems. The advantage of the method that uses energy principles is that it's less likely to make an error because of the directions of the forces. That's the only explanation. All right, just one comment here. We saw that the mass and the stiffness matrices were symmetric, okay? Mass and stiffness matrices are symmetric. Is this always true? The answer is no. If you consider relative displacements, then the mass and stiffness matrices will not be symmetric. Maybe the stiffness matrix is not symmetric, or both. Okay? So this is not a general conclusion. Okay? This is a conclusion for the example that we consider. So if you use relative displacements to define the system, relative displacements are used then these matrices are not symmetric. Okay, so the mass and the stiffness matrices are not always symmetric. So let's stop here. And the next topic that we'll cover in the next lecture is free vibration analysis.